I'm glad to be seen and be here. Now I'm seen and heard.
Okay.
They did not cut off my humorous funny bone. I'm sorry, but and I found out my surgeon has the same sense of humor as Steve Mickelson and I do. So when I go in on the 23rd, he told me some things I have to do in preparation, and one of the things I have to do is bring 3 new jokes in for him. So his staff is like, oh no, another one. So as you're probably all aware, I ended up in the hospital and spent 7 lovely days in a health spa. And as I'll talk about more, things cascaded downward almost the entire time. And it was a rough time. One of the things that ended up getting me through, I ended up having my MP3 player and headphones. And every night, I ended up playing some songs, and there's one song that became my theme song. I played it over and over and over. And in the night, while I was in pain and struggling, and things kept going wrong, I played that over and over, had headphones on. You know how you sing when you have headphones on? I was right near the nurse's station, and I didn't care. And I sang it out loud, lying in my bed with my arms up over and over. So I want to play that song. And to me, that is a reminder of when things go bad, God is still with us. So we're going to play that. The words, hopefully they'll work. We need a new projector bulb. So you should be able to see it. So we're going to play that song now.
Down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again I say amen, and it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. As your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. You are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. Left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm. I remember when I stumbled in the wind, you heard my cry to you and raised me up again. My strength is almost gone. How can I carry on if I can't find you? But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. You are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn,
from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes into the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. Every tear I cry, you hold.
Josh and I then took the paint program, and I made that on my I'm having fun, you know. It's like, you got to have fun. Anyway, so a little bit of a timeline. Oops, there you go. Last June 2012, I went ATVing with my brother, and he was a little slow. He's never ridden before, so I was fooling around. And the roads were really washboard, and it's really fun. You sort of ride the horse, and you pump it, and you're just pounding. Okay. A couple of days after that, my foot was in a lot of pain. My mom had crippling arthritis. I'd helped her care for her, and I'd already had signs I had arthritis in my foot. And so I got this big ball in my foot, and I was gimped up pretty bad, and I thought it was arthritis. And my wife and I said, yep, I'm suffering the effects of arthritis. So a lot of you know I haven't been very active. I've been sort of hobbling around and in pain, but it's arthritis. You know, I got what my mom got, and that's where I'm at. And I have to look at my notes to know what it says next. Okay? So I suffered for over a year with that. Limited my hunting, couldn't go out on drives with guys, and didn't get to go walk or do much outside. I'd sort of painfully get up and then get it out, and then it seemed like it'd ease up and I'd make it on. But then in September, I ended up getting an open wound, a sore on the bottom of my foot. Actually, Karen's diet, which I'd finally decided I needed to do, was helping, and that it seemed like everything was shrinking, and the big callus that had surrounded that ball on my foot sloughed off, and I had this big wound. And so we started treating it, and the wound started out, or well, at one point it was about this big across my whole foot, and we had gotten it down to about the size of a quarter. And so we thought we're beating it. But as Judy pointed out this fall to me, she goes, "You're always sick. What's going on?" And every cold or every flu that went around, I'd go down. And I'd be in bed or at home for a couple of days. And I wasn't really feeling well this fall at all. Art and I went to the Forest Lakes District Conference. I wasn't feeling good. I said, "Art, you got to drive." And if you know Art, that's a challenge for him, and he likes that. He drives race cars, so you imagine. We got there record time, but he drives very safely, too. So we went there, and I had this terrible fever and chills, and we got back, and the wound had flamed open again and was really bad, and Karen and I got very aggressive, and we again shrunk it down, but we could only get it down to about a quarter size, and then we couldn't make progress. And then we were slowly making progress on it. We think, okay, we get this whipped. Sunday night, the 24th, we had the Thanksgiving service, so we had extra service. It was a long, busy day for me. I had done some counseling earlier in the week, and the person I counseled, their kids all had the bad, gnarly stomach flu. So Sunday night, I got shaking and got the chills and a fever, and I went and hibernated down by the wood stove thinking I got the stomach flu. Perfect timing. 3 days after I talked to this person, I got the stomach flu. Was down there all that week. Wasn't really getting any better. Thanksgiving morning, I slept down there just in front of the fire all the time. And Karen was with me, and she had gone upstairs for something. And here again, I'm telling you the picture story. It may not be entirely accurate, but it gives you the understanding of what happened. I felt terrible, and she came downstairs and said, "Honey, I need you near me. I just need you snuggle up against me." And so I grabbed her, and she put her head on my chest, and my heart rate, she ended up hearing it and looking 180 beats per minute. And she looked down at my foot, and overnight it had swollen twice its size. So she says, "We're going to the emergency room." And we got to the emergency room, and they took blood, and they, you know, they do all their little things. And the blood culture came back, and my white cell count was 20,000. Now, the green box, these show you that's normal. And 18,000 white blood cell count is considered life-threatening. And mine was at 20. They told us that when we got there, if Karen had waited an hour or two, I would have been dead. That's how the blood, the infection had broken out of my foot, got in my bloodstream, and was streaming through my body. So they immediately put me on all the high-powered antibiotics they could, IVs, and for 7 days in the hospital and then 3 days afterwards, I was on constant IV antibiotics. One bag would empty, they'd put up a new bag. One bag would empty, they'd put up a new bag. I was also dehydrated, so they were at first pumping saline solution into me, and then I always had that bag hanging there. After they got my... After they got my white blood cell count out of the danger, immediate danger area, they couldn't get it down into the normal range, but they at least got me out of danger, and they weren't worried about me dying immediately. Then they started looking around, and the surgeon came in. He took one look at my foot, and he says, "I know what's wrong." And he did an examination and told us that when I thought I got arthritis, what had really happened is the bones in my foot had broken and my arch had collapsed. And instead of having an arch, I had a rocker foot. And he said, at that point, you were done. When that happened, because of where it was back at the back of the arch near my heel, he said, it really is just a matter of progressing until the day of your amputation. The infection ended up got in my that foot. So on the outside, we were healing it, and it decided, well, I'm not leaving. And it decided to burrow into my foot. So all the soft tissue in my foot was affected and was damaged. It buried into the bone and damaged the bones. So the doctor said, your only hope is an amputation, because even if you could heal it, you've got nothing left for weight bearing. And so, you know, he said amputated, and I went, ooh. And then about a minute later, I said, take it. Amputate it now. And I looked at Karen, and I said, do you agree? And she goes, yes. Because we'd already fought for a year and a half this foot that is damaged, and now we get confirmation from the doctor. There's no hope. He said, no. And then, you know, we said so fast, yes. But he's like, no. Most people wait a year and a half or so, and they try to get healing, and they try to do other things, but then they usually end up amputating it. I said, I don't want to do that. I've already had a year and a half of pain, and it's only gotten worse. Take it. I want to heal. And he did tell us through the examination, I've got good blood flow. I've got good bone structure. I've got good muscle structure. He says, you're a very high candidate for, after you get your prosthesis, to have a very active and full life and pain-free. I'm like, I like the sound of that. Bye. So if you're on Facebook, you probably saw a picture of me the day of my operation. I was looking down at my foot, and it looked sort of lonely and sad. And I asked Karen to get the marker. You know, they always have those marker boards in every hospital room. Give me the marker. And I took and I drew a smiley face on my big toe. And so he kept looking at me, smiling at me, and I smiled at him. I thought, you know, we're going to part company, but we're parting friends. I love you, and I've enjoyed the last 50-some-odd years with you, but you're going one direction, and I'm not going that way. I'm going another. So, and I'll see you again. We'll be reunited at the resurrection when God brings together a new glorified body, and I get that foot back healed and whole. But I'm like, I told the doctor, it's a part of me, but it ain't me. And I said, you're telling me I have a future and a hope of pain and getting back to be able to be active again? I want that. Take the foot. So I had to wait a couple more days to get the infection level down a little bit further. And then they amputated my foot on December the 3rd. And then we were told I'd probably get out on Friday, which sounded pretty soon. But they ended up, I healed well enough and everything looked good. The surgeon pushed, and you know, you get this constellation of doctors and they all have to agree. And he pushed it through, and then I was down to one doctor hadn't signed off, and my nurse came in. She goes, I'm going to get on this case. I'm going to get you out of here. And I'm like, okay, I've been in hospitals with other people enough to know, yeah, right. So I'm like, we're going on Friday or maybe Saturday. And she walks back to the room. I got him to sign off. You got about three things you got to do. Change your clothes. You'll be out here in an hour. And we're like, so during that week, the kids all went to our house and rearranged. We live in a multi-story house. They rearranged and brought a bedroom down to the first floor, moved the TV room, set that up, and did some other things so that I have a place I can go to. A number of things just were wonderfully in place. One of the things is 5 years ago when Karen's stepdad and mother came, we put a handicap ramp on the front of our house. So, and my wife earlier in the week had sent, my brother had come up from St. Louis to be with me, and she sent him out shopping, and she got the walker, and she got this, and she had him get that. So the therapist came in and said, well, you need to do this, this, and this. Done. We got it. And so I didn't have to go to a nursing home. I got to go directly home, and we got home and shocked everybody because we didn't tell anybody because we didn't really believe it was going to happen. And we got home, and that the driveway was icy, and the ramp was icy. And I just sat there and said, I can't get out on this, Karen, because they did say I'm 15 times more likely to have my good foot amputated until I get a prosthesis, because all the weight and everything happens on that one foot. So they said, protect it. And that's why I'm in a wheelchair. I have a walker that I transfer, but they said I have to be in a wheelchair. They don't want me accidentally injuring my good foot, because what have you got left then? Okay? So we had everything. We got home. It's icy. And I said, honey, there's ice melt in the garage. You have to get it out. And, of course, I'm the one who always does it. She has no clue, and I tell her what it looks like. And we hit the button for the garage, and it's frozen shut. Now what are we going to do? And immediately in my heart, call Dick Bedward. And Dick was there. Charlie happened to be over. And I said, oh, by the way, while you're coming over to do that, we also have these handles that need to be installed on the toilet. Could you bring some tools to install that while you're coming? So they were there in about 5 minutes, got it uniced, and got the door open, and Charlie pushed me up the icy ramp to get me in the door, and we were home. And I just thank God for all the people that have helped in many different ways. We found out in our porch that there's a 2-inch lip that you never realize to get into the house. And in our bathroom, the previous owners had remodeled and put in carpet. We ripped all those out. And the hardwood floor in the bathroom had some very rough patches in it, which we'd covered up in rug and forgot about. But now I can't have rugs. We pulled the rugs back, and here's these patches. And so I realized, they said, if you get a splinter in this foot, you're very likely to get an infection. I'm like, I don't know, we're not doing that again. So I called Randy. I said, Randy, could you come help me? So Randy spent the day building a little ramp inside the porch and then patching the floors. My toilet down in that stairs, you don't really realize what you use two legs for. But I had a small bowl toilet when the round and it was short, and it was dangerous for me, and I couldn't use it. So I'm a chaplain for the fire department in Altoona. They said, anything you need, chaplain, you let us know. I called them up and said, I need a toilet. Bigger, longer, taller, and now. So they went, they got some measurements and went to Menards, got me a toilet. And they came over on Saturday to install it, and it was sort of funny because they wanted to see me, as many as they could, so 5 of them came over. And they all went in that little bathroom. And I said, this is the beginning of a joke. How many firemen does it take to change a toilet? So God has just provided in numerous ways during this time. And I'm very grateful. And there's a number of other different things that, and people have done such wonderful gifts for us and just showered us with love and the prayers and the cards. I thank you. I thank you for those. Those have been very encouraging. One of the things, I'm going to tell you a couple of things in the hospital. It was not a fun ride. Besides the first 2 days, I was totally, basically out of it, being so sick. Then as that went down and we're headed towards amputation, at least every day, something cascaded and it went worse. Okay, and one of the things that nobody believed me when it was happening was, I kept telling people, every time I close my eyes, it's like a PowerPoint slideshow. And I can't get the pictures out of my head. And I can't sleep. So this is sort of an idea of what it felt like for me every time I close my eyes. Just all sorts of weird, random pictures would just show up. And I couldn't stop it. And I couldn't sleep. And it was like, and so one day I'm like, I'm picturing a graveyard and there's snow. Now I see this and now I see that. And my family's all, are you making this up? I said, no. I said, I can't sleep. Every time I close my eyes, that kind of stuff is just going on. And it's this constant visual image. And I couldn't stop. I couldn't sleep. And then I finally figured out, I put on my headphones and I've got this long playlist of worship songs. And I'd turn that on and play it loud in my head. And that allowed me to get some sleep. And so that went on, and then we found out, they thought I was a little loony. They found out that's a side effect of one of the antibiotics I was on. I'm like, oh good, I'm justified. I'm like, okay, I feel better now, okay? Now, the next thing, though, that hit was I had so much saline in my body. Saline solution is a salt solution, okay? Keeps you from dehydrating. I had had so much, though, now whenever I cried, and I cried quite a lot, sometimes in worship, sometimes in fear of the next procedure or whatever, my tears would burn my face as they went down. And I just moved my head and my mouth would fill up with saliva. I had so much fluid pumped into me. And it was like drinking, and then it was drinking salt water. And I'd have stuff run down the back of my throat. It was so salty, I'd start retching and I'd dry heave for about 5 minutes. And my stomach was always upset. And they kept saying, you need to eat. I'm like, I can't. I'm just sick at my stomach. So finally, they realized I had too much saline. I said, I don't know what's going on, but I just am salty. I can't take it. It ended up, the salt started, you know, every time I licked my lips, it was like I'd eaten a bunch of Fritos, and they were all salty without all the good flavor. Okay? So it was just salty everywhere. Salt started to exude through my body, and if you've ever had that, it's very itchy and painful. I got to one night, I need some sleep. I tried for 2 hours of sleep. I couldn't get comfortable. I kept tossing and turning. And my poor wife, because she was there helping me every moment of the day. Honey, I need the pillow moved. No, help me turn. Look, no, that didn't work. And so I about sent her to tears that night because I was in so much pain and I just kept demanding and asking, trying to find some comfort. And it was very difficult. So after they took me off saline a day or so later, then I started to feel better, and some of that reduced. It wasn't until after I got home, though, that it was totally eradicated. But that's just a couple of some of the fun side effects of hospitalization. There's a couple of psalms I want to read, too. Psalm 124, if the Lord had not been on our side when my illness attacked me, it would have swallowed us alive. When their anger flared against us, the flood would have engulfed us, the torrent would have swept over us, the raging waters would have swept us away. I had issue after issue, found out, and I had a strep infection in my blood, and they said when it goes to your bloodstream, it attacks heart valves. I had several diagnostic tests done, and the early tests all showed that two of my valves were leaking, and I was headed towards heart surgery. They did finally the last test, which is they put a scope down your throat. It's an ultrasound scope, and I was scared to death of that, feeling like gagging. And then I've had a sinus infection. Here's a positive. I've had a chronic sinus infection for years. After all the IVs I've been on, antibiotics, I don't have a sinus infection anymore. But I've not slept. I've always slept with my head up. So a level bed feels like I'm downhill. For this procedure, you have to go downhill. If you ever have a bad sinus infection, you know what happens when your head goes low? You plug up and you can't breathe, and they got stuff down my throat, and what am I going to do? And I was panicking. It turned out that's the definitive test, the last test before surgery. Turned out, I made it through. It wasn't too bad until they pulled the tube out, and it was like, damn it. And the doctor couldn't find any sign of the heart valves leaking. He said, I had a hard time. I had to go back and look at the original scans to figure out which were the two I was even supposed to look at, because there's no sign of any damage. There's no leakage. It wasn't until after I got home, all of a sudden it hit me. I'm like, wait a minute. Because they said, well, maybe your blood pressure lowered or whatever. My blood pressure has been about the same, whacked out the whole time. They had no clue why it didn't happen. All of a sudden I went, ding. God did a miracle. God did a miracle for me. Because I'm like, God, I've gone through so much. I can take the amputation, but heart surgery on top of this? Come on, Lord, give me a break. So I just went back to praise him in the storm. You know, it's like, okay, it's still raining, Lord. I thought you would have rescued me. But if you don't, you'll be there with me. I'll be okay. So I asked Karen, I said, did you ever think about that? She goes, oh, when the doctor said it, I thought God healed him. I'm like, oh, I'm a little slow on the uptake. Which I realize I have a high tolerance for pain. I'm not the brightest duck in the pond. And that's probably why I thought I had a arthritis instead of a broken foot for a year and a half. It's like, okay. So I decided to put this up on the slide and read it because I want you to understand this is very, very true. Because in this process, there's a number of prayers that God answered of mine. And I'm not going to go into detail, but there were a number of long-term things I've been praying for. And I said, God, I don't know how you're going to ever answer these because I can't figure out how to answer them. I don't know how to overcome it. And God says, done! Chop off the leg! And all these things started falling into place and a number of my prayers were answered. And so I can honestly say I would not take my foot back, even if it was whole and healthy, if I had to trade away the things that I have gained. Ponder that for a minute. I don't want that foot back because if that's the price I have to pay for having those prayers answered that are very important to me, thank you, Jesus. You answered prayer. That foot, I don't care. Those prayers, I never, never would trade those away. So in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of uncertainty and problems, I got to tell you, I am so blessed. I don't look at myself as, oh, pity. And if you see my Facebook page, I think you understand I'm not pitying myself in any way. I'm enjoying life. I have a future. And I have a hope. And I'm very, very satisfied. I did tell my wife, I said, well, I know that you've always assumed this, and now you have verification. I am a high-maintenance man. And speaking of not quite getting it, after I've been home a few days, you know, I'm pretty upbeat. And then one of my cousins said, well, what's going on about the prosthesis? I said, well, the medical profession really doesn't tell you a lot. They tell you what's next. And I said, I figured out the reason is they don't want to tell you everything. Because if you don't heal at that rate or something doesn't happen, then you're going to get mad, you're going to get frustrated, you're going to get depressed. So I know on December the 23rd, I'm going in, and they're supposed to start removing staples. I may not remove them all, they might start removing every other one. My leg sort of looks like upholstery down there, where they put the seam together and it's a row of staples. So if you got a leather couch, look at the arm of your chair and so the rivets, I got staples. And he did a wonderful job, beautiful job. But, what was I saying? You don't remember it? Oh, I know that I'm going to have staple removed on December 23rd, and then they'll start telling me. Probably in February, I'll start being fitted with the temporary prosthetic, and then I'll have a lot of physical therapy. They say almost no one ever can figure out how to walk on a prosthetic without physical therapy. It's just a different enough thing. So I've got a lot of doctor's appointments ahead of me. I got a lot of things in my future. I got a lot of exercise and work. I'm doing exercises now, but I figured they're really sort of baby exercises, and I'll get to big boy school soon as this is healing. And it's a lot less painful. I haven't really had that much pain. I quickly, in the hospital, you know, they had me with the morphine button. And I hit it about 5 times, and then I got thinking, what's the difference between discomfort and pain? And I thought, I don't think I've had pain yet. So I told him to take that out. And except for when the doctor first changed the dressing, you know, he came in, do you want some pain meds? I said, I don't know, do I? And he goes, yeah, I think you do. And I was glad that I took it. But other than that, I've taken no pain medication. The bandage has to be changed every day, so when Karen rolls that sock down off my foot the last 2 inches, at first I was pretty well screaming, and now I just sort of go, and that's it. That's all the pain I've got. So I praise God. I have wanted to cross my ankles and raise my leg to try to do that a number of times. And you can't cross your ankles if you only have one. So I have weird sensations like that, but really no pain. So we got back home, and I've lost the page I need. I'm going to find it here. Did I put some on the floor? Oh, well, that's why. Hi, I'm a... Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So, another scripture passage. Psalm 62. Yes, my soul, find rest in God. My hope comes from Him. Truly, He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I'll not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God, for He is a mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him. God is our refuge. And then here's the timeline that I know of. December 23rd is when I go back to see my surgeon. And we should get staples removed. It looks like it's healing very nicely. I've got a couple of red spots, but nothing to call the doctor on. December 24th, my plan. Next Sunday, we're having somebody come in and preach. I don't have enough energy at this point. My batteries run out pretty quick, so I'm not preaching next Sunday. We're having somebody come in and preach. I plan to be at church, but not preach. December 24th, the Christmas Eve service. As weird as it'll be, I'm planning to lead that service. And then hopefully, I'm going to resume preaching that next Sunday. January 20, 2014, multitudes upon multitudes of doctors and physical therapies appointments should be starting as I'm seeing all my different doctors and start physical therapy. I'll probably resume working full-time in January. I'll be doing a little bit more at home, but I just don't have the energy to do a lot right now. I decided I have the life of a cat. Right now I get up at 4:30 in the morning with Karen because she has to get to work by 6. So we get up, she changes my dressing, I do my exercises, she makes breakfast, we do blood pressures and blood sugars and all that stuff. And then she leaves at 6, and usually I go back to bed for a little while. And then I wake up, and I'm hungry, because I ate at 5 o'clock in the morning, now it's 8:30. So I'm a hobbit, because I have a second breakfast. And then I take a nap. Or, you know, get a little, you know. So it's like, I eat, sleep, lay around, eat, sleep, lay around. I'm like, I'm a cat. So, in February, they suggest that I should be fitted with my temporary prosthesis. And they say, you know, that's it's a test for them to get a fit and then figure out, you know, what I can do and what my lifestyle is. I asked, will I be able to hunt? And they said, in the right terrain. So I'll probably be talking to some farmers and seeing if I can do the field rather than go in the woods. I asked about my motorcycle, and he said, yep, no problem. You'll be able to ride. Firemen got a riding group, and they're like, cool, we'll go ride that summer. I said, yeah, I'm not going to ride alone anymore. I think Stumpy's going to need some riding partners. My future is bright. It's going to take me probably all the way through summer to build up my muscles in the time endurance that I need. I'll always have a wheelchair accessible that I'm going to need on occasions. because you don't just strap those things on and leave them on 24/7. But I'm content. I'm happy. I have a future. I have a love for Jesus, and I'm very, very thankful for what I've gone through. So, continue to pray for me. There is, when I first looked at that site about prosthesis, and I saw the process, I told Karen, I said, I got a little low, I went back to bed and put the blanket on my head, and put my headphones in and started listening to worship music. And within about an hour, I was recentered and back on top again. So, God's been very good to me. I'm very thankful for His goodness and for His love. So, thank you for your prayers and support. And I know many people have asked us how they can help. Right now, the number one thing is just continue to pray. I have been asking different people things that I know they can do. And I'm very thankful for that. And as, let's just say that as time goes by, I'm going to need more help. And we're going to need more assistance as we start to figure out what I can and can't do. So you might be called on. And people want to bring over food. And the problem with that is I'm on a very restrictive diet. And it's easier for us just to get the food that we're going to eat and that we can in the right amount, because it's just Karen and I. And so, you know, it's like, remember my last sermon I preached about manna and hating leftovers? So Karen and I have had a few manna days here. We're like, okay, Lord, thank you, Jesus, for this food, and we eat it. But it's like, so thank you for your offers of food. At this point, it's best not. So just hang on to that urge. And what I would encourage you to do, in honor of me, find somebody to help. Give them a visit. Give them a call. Take them a meal. Do something kind. That'd be a great way to honor me. As you, I know many of you have expressed you want to help. Now, having said that, I do have one commercial announcement. We have a built-in dishwasher that died, and we've just left it. We have a portable dishwasher because we use it for counter space. But everything is too, you know, I'm like this in the counters. Dick Bedward is building me a table. But that means I need the portable dishwasher installed. And take the permanent dishwasher out and install the portable dishwasher. I've done it before, but I'm sort of not able to get down and do that work again. So if you have plumbing experience, if you've ever done that before, that I need somebody to help me with. It's about a $15, $20 kit and about 3 hours stuck underneath the kitchen cabinet. But it's already had dishwashers, so it should work okay. And if nobody here can do that, I've got the fire department. I know somebody in the police department that has remodeled their house. I can get help. But I want to give you guys first dibs. Okay? So, I love you and thank you. And I just want to pray right now. Father, I thank you for the love that you have showered upon me. I thank you for you giving me and my wife strength through these days. I thank you for the rest that you're giving us as we slowly rebuild our strength and as we look to the future. I thank you for the love of this congregation and the prayer support and the visits and just the myriad of little helpful ways that people have demonstrated their love. Lord, I thank you for changing me, for challenging me, and being with me every step of the way. And I pray, Father, I know that I'm not the only one hurting and in need. Maybe mine's a little drastic and shocking, but I just pray for others. I think of Sandy Peterson in the hospital for over a month. Oh, Lord, give her peace and comfort. And there's so many people that in this last fall that I've not been able to minister to because I've been so focused upon my own needs. I just pray, Father, that you will help me, strengthen me, guide me to begin to reach out again and do those things. I thank you for all the people in the church that have stepped up and have gone an extra mile to cover for my absence. And I just pray you'd bless them. I think it's a good thing for each of us as we seek to serve and use the gifts you've given us. We ask, O Lord, that as a congregation, that you would use us to change each one of us. It's so easy to go through the motions, to think, I'm okay with God, when really all we have is a rut that we're in. Or it's easy to focus upon ourselves when we come to church, looking at how we can be ministered to and taken care of. I pray you'd help us become outward focused, to look around, to acknowledge the needs. And Lord, I know it's been very tough on me. I'm a giver, and I help people, and it's been very tough for me to receive. But I know it's right. And so I pray you'd help each one of us, Lord, as we struggle through these kind of issues in our life, to give and to receive, to accept blessing, and what we see is not blessing from you. You are the God who gives and takes away. But I always know that you give more than you take. And when you take stuff, it's bad. And it's better for us without it. So, Lord, I affirm that I trust you, and I affirm that we as a congregation trust and believe that you will guide us and lead us and make us better for all that we are suffering and for all the ways in which it seems like we're getting numbed, but I know what you're really doing, Lord. You're preparing us for greater ministry and a greater opportunity to glorify your name. So thank you, Jesus, for all you've done.